Today on Top Shelf Sports, we'll check in with three NIU gymnasts as they prepare for regional competition. This week's leader of the pack is in love with diamonds. Find out why. And star outfielder Scooter Bynum joins us in the Huskie Corner. Top Shelf Sports starts now.
Welcome to Top Shelf Sports. I'm Nicole Ryan.
And I'm Brandon Giese. It's April and it's still snowing. Can you believe that, Nicole?
No, I can't. But I know that the NIU Athletics Department isn't too happy about it because of so many games being canceled.
Yeah, let's just hope that that doesn't affect the men's tennis team. So that's what we're going to start with. Actually, we're going to get right into that. Yes, the men's tennis team is looking to carry their momentum after their winning match against Ball State Saturday afternoon. Ball State had a commanding 3-1 lead until the Huskies made a comeback by winning the last three singles matches. With the victory, the men's tennis team improves their record to 13-6 overall and 3-1 in the Mid-American Conference. They will be heading to New York State for a rematch against Binghamton on Sunday, April 8th.
We'll stay on the hard court and check in on the women's tennis team. Coming off of four straight losses, they look to get back on track in Buffalo, New York. There are only two MAC matches left in their schedule, and with a 0-4 conference record, these are must wins. First serve is at noon.
The NIU gymnastics season is far from over as three talented gymnasts have moved on to postseason play. Top Shelf Sports reporter Tom Burton has more.
Three NIU gymnasts are taking their talents to Alabama this weekend for the NCAA Regionals. Senior captains and all-around gymnasts Catherine Prentice and Ashley Potts qualified for the event for the second time, along with junior floor specialist Anna Martucci qualifying for the first time. All three have been training hard for this event, and head coach Sam Morielli has high hopes for his three captains.
The hope is we can just go there and have fun, and I really truly think all three of these kids can qualify through, which would be really cool.
Catherine Prentice is a second-time qualifier for the NCAA Regionals. The all-around gymnast was named to the MAC Championship All-Second Team after recording a career-high score of 39.3 in the MAC Championships. The senior captain hopes to build on her experiences at the event from last season.
Last year I didn't really set as many goals other than to go and hit my events. Obviously that's still something I want to do my best on each event, but I think Nationals is definitely in the picture.
Ashley Potts will also make her second appearance at the NCAA Regionals. Potts led the Huskies in vault, uneven bars, and all-around scores this season, leading to a MAC all-first team selection. In what could be the final meet of Potts' NIU career, she is going into it with a strong mentality.
Pretty much just do one more meet, see what happens, see where I can go. I'm not trying to like overthink anything and put too much pressure on myself.
Anna Martucci will join her two senior teammates as a regional qualifier in the floor routine. The MAC Floor Specialist of the Year earned herself a score of 9.975 March 4th against Western Michigan, the highest score by a Huskie since 1995. Making it to this event is a dream come true for Martucci, as she is set to join an exclusive list of NIU gymnasts as an NCAA regional qualifier.
This has been a goal for me since freshman year, so it's cool to see that goal and dream come into play and be able to do that, and I can't wait to do so.
The event is set for tomorrow in Alabama. I'm Tom Burton for Top Shelf Sports.
The Huskies won their final five matches of the season. Let's hope they have another one in them.
Huskie triple jumper Javonia White made her outdoor season debut last weekend with a record-setting performance. White set a school record in the triple jump competition with a distance of 12.69 meters, and she secured a third-place finish in the Stanford Invitational. Javonia and the rest of the team are back in action tomorrow at Alabama's Crimson Tide Invitational in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Go get them, girls!
NIU softball junior outfielder Jenny Van Giertree is in the midst of a breakout season. Van Giertree was named Mid-American Conference West Division Player of the Week. The junior batted 750 with two home runs and seven RBI in the Huskies' four-game sweep against UIC in Buffalo. You can catch Jenny and the rest of the team at home this weekend as they take on the Ohio Bobcats. Speaking of softball, one of NIU's very own has been heating up on the diamond. I got a chance to catch up with the ace of the staff.
Senior softball pitcher Tara Thacker's success reaches far beyond the diamond. Her accomplishments have not gone unnoticed, as she has won a variety of awards over the years. But even with all of these accolades, what really stands out? Her versatility.
I was used to starting every single game in high school and all the way through. So then last year, when I was kind of a mixture of both, it was nice to be able to start some games and finish them, just wherever anybody needed me to help, whatever I could do for our success.
Tara's determination to win is unmatched. As a senior, she understands what it takes to compete at a high level. Head coach Christina Sutcliffe knows there aren't many people as determined as Tara.
I love about Tara is you can walk up to a game and you have no idea if she's winning or losing. She just has her game face on, is super competitive, and there's really no hitter that she thinks she can't get out.
Tara's passion for the game has always fueled her success. Her all-around skills are a testament to her hard work and dedication. She wants to continue to be a leader for the Huskies, as her attention to detail has led her to become the team's undisputed ace.
Practicing all the way through high school and everything, it was a lot of repetition. Like, I would have hour and a half, 2 hour practices just going over and over, just making sure I could hit those consistently, all pitches actually. So I think once I got to college, it was a lot easier for me to focus on those, perfecting those pitches and pinpointing exactly where I needed it to go.
Tara's unselfishness and commitment to winning leaves her as this week's leader of the pack.
With Tara's unique ability to lead by example, she hopes to guide the Huskies to a successful season.
Taking it from one diamond to another, the baseball team is struggling to fit in games due to the weather. After canceling their third consecutive game today, the Huskies are hoping to start a 3-game set with the Western Michigan Broncos at some point this weekend. There is a doubleheader scheduled for tomorrow, beginning at noon, if the weather allows them to play. With a poor 2-4 record in MAC play, the team needs to bring out the brooms to get back on track. One good thing about the cancellations is that the baseball team had a little extra free time this week.
Yes, they certainly did, Nicole, and that allowed our very own Top Shelf sports reporter Scott Nickel to sit down with their star Scooter Bynum during this week's weird weather.
Thanks, guys. All right, Scooter, so in high school you were named Gatorade Player of the Year in both basketball and baseball, yeah. And you also played a little football as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, what made you gear towards baseball?
The biggest opportunity to grow was a sport that I hadn't played at the high level before. I played basketball at a high level and you know, football at the high school level. But I just thought I can get, my ceiling was higher on baseball, so that's why I chose to go to JUCO and ended up here.
So how did JUCO, Western, or Arizona Western,
yeah.
How did that help, you know, when you transformed, or when you transferred to NIU?
Yeah, the Arizona JUCO League is a really, really competitive league. We had a couple players on the team right now. Hunter Bross is from that same league, and really competitive, got a bunch of draft picks in that league. So it's a hard knock league. It's 70 games a year. It's 115 degrees when you first step on campus. So it's a really good league.
So a little different weather than what we have
here. 110% different, yeah.
When, you know, growing up, was there a player that you wanted to, you know, emulate or have your game go after?
My favorite player was Adam Jones of the Orioles, so he still plays, and I still watch him play today. I have all his jerseys, so that's who I want to emulate.
Okay. Yeah. What about his game do you like?
I think he's a bigger center fielder. He's not necessarily the fastest guy in the world. You know, he doesn't have, like, an amazing arm or anything like that, but he just gets it done. He's an all-star guy. He's really good.
For sure. Yeah. So you led the team last season in average hits, triples, steals, and slugging percentage. So is there anything, you know, this offseason that you really, really wanted to work on coming into your senior year?
I just wanted to get better, and every baseball player wants to get better, you know, every day. It's one of the hardest sports to play, I believe, in all the sports, because I've played most of the sports. But I just want to get better, and senior year is going to be a lot tougher. The scouting report's out on me right now, and I'm just trying to grind through that.
For sure. Right. Did you set any, like, personal goals or anything?
Yeah, I would like to obviously continue playing after this senior year, and I want to not only make it to the playoffs this year. We made it to the playoffs last year, but I want to, you know, make some noise in the playoffs this year.
So when you say continue playing, does that mean you want to possibly go pro, or what are you thinking?
That's everybody's goal. Don't let anybody lie to you. They want to go pro. So that's obviously the goal, and that's the plan.
Okay. Yeah. So for games, what's your favorite sunflower seed?
I got to go with sweet and spicy. You can only get them at one place. You can only get them at Casey's.
Really?
In town, yeah.
Sweet and spicy. See, I was more of a pickle guy myself.
Okay, gotcha,
I like those ones.
Yeah.
But I've never had the sweet and spicy.
Yeah, they're really good.
All right. Yeah. So, you know, what's the most noticeable difference here between Fairbanks, Alaska, where you're from, and DeKalb, Illinois?
Right now, not much, because our weather is kind of, you know, kind of ridiculous. But usually, it's a lot colder where I'm from. The sun stays out longer in the summertime, and then, you know, it's all dark all winter. So the cold is not what I got to adjust to. It's kind of the wind. The wind here is unreal.
Yeah. I would agree.
Yeah.
So does that help you on game day at all, or is it kind of like Wrigley where?
No, it actually does help sometimes. I have a lot more cold gear than most of the guys do, just from home. And then, but the wind, like I said, the wind is a game changer, man. It exposes everybody, so nobody's immune to the cold.
When you're not playing baseball or, you know, studying or whatever, what are you doing?
Just hanging out with my friends. I mean, my roommates are great. We're pretty close to the team, so we all live in, most of us live in the Knolls, and some of our guys live on Aspen, all that good stuff. But we're pretty close to with each other, and we just hang out.
Awesome. So. Biggest question here. To win a game, would you rather hit a walk-off home run or rob somebody of hitting a walk-off home run?
100% hit a walk-off home run.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Just coming through for your team. Yeah.
Have you ever done that?
I have never hit a walk-off home run. It's on the bucket list,
awesome.
That's for sure.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Scooter.
Anytime.
Appreciate your time. Good luck the rest of the year.
Thank you.
Yeah. Back to you guys, Brandon and Nicole.
When we come back, he's failed literally everything else, but we'll see if Nico has what it takes to be a bullpen catcher.
We'll send Emily out to test your knowledge on NIU athletics, and Kobe will update us on the Chicagoland area. Is the Bulls tank working? Stay with us.
These are cool. Did you,
King.
Go fish.
Stay out, stay here, fish.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today.
What?
With softball season in full swing, Top Shelf Sports' very own Nico Poulos joined the Husky Sluggers to see if he has what it takes to join their pack.
Now, we have seen how Nico has done before, so I'm a little optimistic heading into this one.
Fingers crossed!
I took my talents to the softball field to try out as their bullpen catcher with the help of junior pitcher Alex Friends. Though a long shot, I had to try to make my dream of being a bullpen catcher come true. After some warm-up catch, it was time to put on the gear and get behind the plate.
Looking good, huh?
Yeah.
Even with my long baseball playing experience, I truly didn't expect what was coming, as I fell on nearly every pitch.
Alright, so that was just a warm-up. And we're about to do regular pitches. I'm already gassed, and I don't know if I'm gonna catch one of these, so let's see what happens.
Well, what happened was more of the same. Miss, and another miss. Alex even tried to throw me a couple change-ups to slow it down, but that didn't go any better. I was able to catch a few, but I obviously didn't make the cut.
So, just caught a bullpen for Alex Friends, and it went just as poorly as everything else has gone. I'm obviously not a catcher. She fooled me on more than one occasion, made me look pretty dumb, and yeah, safe to say my catching career is out the window.
For Top Shelf Sports, I'm Nico Poulos.
Yeah, Nicole, I take my optimism back. I think that he has to keep looking for his sport because this one just didn't work out.
Yeah, I think maybe he should go back to long jumping. That's his most successful one yet.
I don't know about that one either. With MLB baseball starting up and NBA playoffs ahead of us, sometimes we forget about our very own Huskie athletes.
Top Shelf sports reporter Emily LaRusso is on campus quizzing students on your NIU sports teams.
Thanks, guys. I'm out here on the streets testing students' knowledge on NIU athletics. Let's go find out how much they know. Okay, so what's the name of NIU's mascot?
The NIU Huskie.
Victory Huskie.
Victory Huskie.
Yeah.
Wow.
His name is Mission.
No, close. Victor E.
Victor E.
Victor E. Huskie.
There you go.
Victory.
Yeah, there you go.
Our mascot is Victor E. Huskie.
There you go. Good job. Okay. What MLB team does a baseball team normally, like, partner up with?
What MLB team does?
Yeah, out of the two Chicago teams.
Oh, probably the White Sox.
Oh, isn't it the... It's the White Sox, I believe.
Yeah, you're right. You got not
the... The here. Chicago White Sox?
Yes, good job.
White Sox?
Mm-hmm, but there you go. And then what is the name of the NIU head football coach?
Head football coach.
He's got a parking spot up, Daddy. Oh. Sorry, I always say his name.
Oh my god. I don't know that one.
Rod Carey.
I think his name is Brandon Cavallunas.
Rod Carey.
Rod Carey. Ah.
Oh, Rod Carey.
Mm-hmm. Pass.
Rod Carey.
Rod Carey.
Do you know who the leading scorer was for the MAC? He played at NIU basketball.
God, I'm awful. Awesome.
It's okay.
No, I don't.
It's okay.
Kenny Battle?
Eugene German. Here you go.
Yes. Oh, man. I don't know that one.
Eugene German.
Eugene German?
Yep. And well, it looks like our students could do a little bit better on their NIU athletics trivia. Well, from this winter wonderland that is DeKalb, back to you guys. Wow. Those are some flaky answers.
Enough with the snow puns, Nicole.
All right, Brandon. NIU students definitely need to brush up on their school trivia.
You know, I can agree with you on that, Nicole, but there is something for them. We're going to send it over to Kobe Price now to check in on what's happening outside of NIU athletics.
Thank you. I know I'm usually standing somewhere over there, but that isn't going to stop me from delivering another edition of Kobe's Madness. Now, this is a special edition, seeing as though it's unfortunately the last one of the year, because the Villanova Wildcats defeated the Michigan Wolverines to become the 2018 NCAA Tournament champions. The Wolverines led on early, but Villanova battled back behind the record-setting play of the Final Four Most Outstanding Player of the Year, Dante DiVincenzo. DiVincenzo scored the 31 points, which is the most points off the bench in a Final Four game in tournament history. The Wildcats pulled off the 79-62 victory against Michigan to secure their second national title in the past three seasons and cement their spot in the NCAA record books. Now we're going to go from the hard court to the greener pastures of life to discuss a tradition like no other. The playing of the 82nd Masters Tournament is underway right now as we speak, as Texas native Jordan Spieth was the first round leader after shooting a 6-under 66 in the opening round. Spieth is currently struggling in round two as he is a 4-over par on the day and one shot off the lead. Tiger Woods is off to the first tee in the second round after shooting 1-over par in the first round. There is currently a 7-way tie for the lead at 3-under par. Also, the MLB season is fully underway, and the defending champion Houston Astros are picking up right where they left off last year with a 6-1 record through the opening week of the 2018 campaign. The Boston Red Sox are proving to be the beast of the AL East with a 6-1 record and an MLB best 2.09 ERA thanks to the otherworldly play of pitchers David Price and Chris Sale. The Minnesota Twins are at the top of the AL Central and had the honor of having a bald eagle land on Jane Paxton's shoulder. The New York Mets have the best record in the NL East and with a top five hitting and pitching unit, and the Arizona Diamondbacks lead the NL West with a 6-1 record, while the Pittsburgh Pirates have the best record in the NL Central with a 5-1 record. Now, speaking of the NL Central, the Chicago Cubs travel to Milwaukee to take on the Brewers this weekend. We go to the second, where John Lester pokes one up the middle, and thanks to an outfield error and heads-up base running by Javier Baez, comes all the way from first to score. Lester was also brilliant on the mound, pitching 6 scoreless innings while striking out 6 batters en route to an 8-0 victory. The Cubs finish off the 4-game series this weekend before the home opener against the Pittsburgh Pirates. Now, to the chagrin of Northsiders, the Chicago White Sox have a 3-3 record just like the Cubs. The White Sox bats have shown up in a big way to start the season as they smacked a MLB-high 14 home runs in their first 6 games of the year. Unfortunately, the bullpen is leaving a lot to be desired as the Sox are the worst in the league in NRA and they've surrendered the 2nd most hits in the MLB. The Blackhawks' dismal season is finally coming to a close as they travel to St. Louis Wednesday to take on the Blues. We'll pick it up in the third with Alex DeBrincat sneaking it past Blues goaltender Jake Allen to tie the game up. There will be no overtime though, with Duncan Keith ripping one-timer past Allen to win the game with 8.5 seconds on the clock. The Hawks round out the end of their season this weekend, taking on the Blues again tonight and the Winnipeg Jets on Saturday. Now, the Bulls have been looking good as of late, which I don't know if that's great news or bad news. Winning 3 of their last outings, Lauri Markkanen balled out against the Charlotte Hornets, scoring 2 of his 24 points on a transition layup midway through the 2nd corner. Charlotte made a late push with a absolutely sick dunk by Malik Monk that may have ended David Nwaba's career. I still don't know if he's in the league right now. I still have to check. The Bulls went on a 14-10 run to finish off the Hornets to win their 3rd straight game. Chicago will be in Beantown tonight, taking on the 2nd-best team in the Eastern Conference, the Boston Celtics. Tip-off will be at 6 p.m. Well, that's all for national sports, and that's also all for Kobe's Madness. Thank you for going through that with me. Brandon, Nicole, that's you two at the desk.
After the break, Top Shelf sports reporter Mike Mitchell will give you some tips on how to get off to a good start in your fantasy baseball season.
And we have a well-rounded top plays that you can't miss. We'll be right back.
Are your children in the right car seat for their age and size? It may be too late to check when you're on the road. Fortunately, you're on the couch. Don't think you know. Know you know.
Hi, I'm Peter. And there's nothing I love more than sharing vegetables with my friends.
Come on in!
Help yourself to anything! That's why we give our food the utmost respect it deserves. Did you know? There are simple steps we can all take to help save food. You can cook it, store it, even share it. Just don't waste it. Because when it comes to food, better eat than never. To learn more, visit SaveTheFood.com.
Testing. Why did the girl ask the mushroom to dance? Because he was a fun guy.
With baseball season in full swing, that also means it's fantasy baseball time. And Nicole, the season's only a week old, but my team's already in the dumpster.
Brandon, seriously, it doesn't matter what sport it is, you're always in the dumps. Hopefully Mike Mitchell can get you back on track.
I'm gonna need it.
Welcome aboard, I'm Mike Mitchell. It's only been a week in the MLB season, but some players are already showing more than rust. They stink. I'm here to help you out. Let's get started with Dodgers catcher Yasmani Grandal. Grandal started the year with over a 400 batting average. He's owned in under 70% of leagues and is a player that can impact your team for not just now, but the entire season. Sticking to the diamond, we have another infielder, guy who is having a breakout first week, and it's Diamondback shortstop Nick Ahmed. Ahmed is also batting over 400. He's an RBI machine in this first week, and if he can continue to be hot, he is someone who you really should stomp on and get. He's owned in under 20% of fantasy leagues and is more than worth a flyer on. Now we're heading out to the outfield with a rookie. My buy low is Preston Tucker. Tucker burst onto the scene in spring training and has been nothing but on fire since making the 25-man roster. He is owned in under 3% of fantasy leagues and is a guy I would pick up ASAP. He's on a horrendous ball club and will have every chance in the world to succeed. Now let's head off to the rubber. Last time we heard his name was 2015. It's Matt Harvey. Over 2016 and 2015, Matt Harvey was constantly plagued with injuries. But now he seems back to himself, bloody and all. He pitched 5 shutout innings in his first start, and this weekend will have a true test against the Washington Nationals. If he succeeds, wow. As the league transitions to be more of a bullpen-oriented league, relievers have become an essential commodity in your fantasy team. Look for the Reds' Raisel Iglesias to be more than a good pickup. He has a nasty slider, high 90s fastball, and plays in pitcher-friendly weather, at least through the spring. He'll be an instant standout for your team, so go ahead and get him. And finally, the player you've all been waiting for, my sleeper of the week. My sleeper of the week is the Giants second baseman, Joe Panik. Panik has been a home run machine so far, bashing 3 home runs in his first week of the season. He's batting close to .500 in his own and under half of fantasy leagues. Joe Panik is an emerging star in the game of baseball and is my sleeper of the week. That's all for fantasy baseball. Hopefully you're no longer panicking, just like Joe Panik. Get it? I'm Mike Mitchell, and in the words of Twins closer Fernando Rodney, let's send it back to the desk.
The UFC is back. Let's release our MMA host.
He's a real hound dog right on the trail of MMA news. And me for snow puns.
Thanks, Brendan and Nicole. I'm David the Hound Dog Craighead, and this is your MMA update. On Thursday of this week, Conor McGregor and about 30 cohorts were led into the Barclays Center, and they assaulted a bus full of UFC fighters hurling chairs and other objects which one would not like to be hit with. As a result of this gang activity, the fight card for UFC that we have been waiting for 3 weeks, this fight card is now in turmoil, as many of the UFC fighters on that bus were on the main card. Breaking news this morning as Khabib Nurmagomedov fight for the title with Max Holloway and main event of UFC 223 has been thrown into limbo. Max Holloway has been declared unfit to fight by the fight doctors, and it is unclear as to if this has anything to do with Conor McGregor's assault on the Barclays Center. In the lead up to the title brawl, Anthony Pettis was to fight Michael Chiesa. Chiesa was on the bus McGregor assaulted and received several facial cuts and was deemed unfit to fight by the UFC. In other MMA news, Dana White has condemned Conor's actions as disgusting and has tried to distance McGregor from the UFC. McGregor turned himself into the police late last night. Changing gears, the biggest boxing matchup of the year has been canceled. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, Canelo Alvarez withdrew his title fight rematch against current champ Gennady Golovkin. Canelo tested positive for steroids, a classic mistake by athletes around the globe. Canelo has blamed it on bad meat, what this reporter calls a convenient excuse. That will wrap it up for the Hound Dog. Back to the experts, Brandon and Nicole at the desk.
And I don't know about you, Nicole, but I am beyond stoked for this top 5 plays.
Come on, Brandon. You should know by now that the top 5 plays of the week are my favorite aspect of
the
show.
Well, don't mind if I do. I'm going to get her started. She's a beauty, that number 5. Adam Eaton has had his struggles with injury towards ACL, but now, look at this, making amazing diving plays. He ended up leaving this game with a tweaked ankle. Not on that play. As you can see, he actually got that one very easily. Braves beat the Nats 7-1.
Moving right along to the number 4 spot, we have Phoenix Suns small forward Danielle House throwing a pass not to himself but to a teammate. House Jr. pumps fast Swaggy P and dunks it in.
At number 3, we're going to head to the UEFA Champions League. The cross to the GOAT, Cristiano Ronaldo. And take a look at his elevation on this. He does the bicycle kick, not an easy one by any means. Celebration is real and Real Madrid wins 3-0.
And in the number 2 spot, we head back to the hardwood with Mavericks rookie Dennis Smith Jr. with a steal. Now it's showtime. Bounce off the floor to himself. Mavs win a rare 115-109.
And the top play of this week, it goes to Josh Reddick. Take a look at this. On a night where the Stros received their rings, Reddick robs this one. Then he comes up. He proceeds to hit a go-ahead grand slam after this play concludes. What a big night overall for the Astros. They're going to take the win all off of this go-ahead slam, 10-6.
You know, Brandon, that had a lot of similarities to the last game played at Minute Maid Park.
Yeah, you know, that game was incredible, but Game 5 of the World Series is going to go down in history forever.
I agree.
Top Shelf Sports is produced and directed by students here at Northern Illinois University.
For more on Top Shelf Sports, look us up and like us on Facebook. Be on the lookout for our various podcasts on SoundCloud. You can also check out our Twitter site at topshelf_NIU to keep up with the latest sports content.
We want to thank you all for joining us. And as always,
go Huskies!